Okay, this is the March 6th meeting of the Conway Selectboard. We have Frontier Community Access Television recording tonight. Joe is here to record for us. Anybody else recording the meeting? No? Okay. Heidi, how are you? Come on in. First item on the agenda, minutes for the February 27th meeting. Has everybody reviewed the minutes?
Yep, look good.
Look good.
Any changes or additions?
No.
Okay, I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes for February 27th.
Second.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Next item on the agenda, we have three warrants. We have a vendor warrant for $77,242. Payroll warrant for $100,565 and a payroll deduction warrant of $26,097. I'll make a motion that we approve those warrants. I have a second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Meetings attended by select board members. Well, in the last week, we attended quite a few meetings. I'm not sure we have to go into all of them unless there's something anybody wants to elaborate on.
I would. That's one quick comment.
Sure.
I would. Being the incident commander of our tornadoes this past week, I really want to thank both John and Bob for assisting in that operations center for two whole days straight. And then also into the Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday this past week. I think we all did a bang-up job, and you two need to be commended for that. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Robert. I think everybody that, our emergency service personnel did an outstanding job. MEMA did a great job. DRC did a great job. The Northwest Massachusetts Incident Management Team did a great job. Everybody pulled together, we're very fortunate that things were not worse than they were, and we're very fortunate that nobody was injured. So that's great.
And you were a great incident commander.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Kept things moving. Any citizens' concerns? Citizens, do we have any concerns? No, that's good. Okay. Any old business?
So we did have other meetings, though. I mean, we all went to the MMA breakfast on Friday morning.
Oh, that's right. How can we forget the MMA breakfast?
We don't want to forget that.
That's right.
Yeah, the MMA breakfast was very good the other morning. It was over at Greenfield, hosted by Mayor Martin at Greenfield Community College. It was very well attended. There had to be 50, 60 people there.
Packed, yeah.
And we had Stan Rosenberg, president of the Senate, was there. We had Steve Kulik, Peter Kokot, and Paul Mark.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, the news on the state budget wasn't very encouraging. It was probably more encouraging that we got the mosquito report, the mosquito protection report. That was okay. But thanks for reminding me of that. I had totally blanked out on that. And then, of course, we had we did have the lieutenant governor come on Monday, and Congressman Neal come on Friday. So Conway is finally on the map.
Very much.
So all right. Thank you, Bob. Next item on the agenda, develop guidelines for distributing tornado relief funds. Heidi Flanders, Fire Department Auxiliary.
Hi.
So we're just here in an advisory capacity to this. You know, Bob is going to be your liaison, but he's not going to be involved in any votes or deliberation, because this should be a citizen-run committee.
Absolutely. So what I can update you on is we have a letter formed already that will go out to every property owner in the town of Conway. Not just town of Conway.
Spread it a little thin.
That will advise them of where they can go to receive the application. There'll be two physical locations as well as an online location where they can pick up applications. And they'll be attached to those applications will be indications on where that needs to be returned to. And one question I had was if there's a possibility to use the town's bulk mail to be able to distribute that or not, but or if you knew of another source of bulk mail.
I think that'll be okay, don't you think?
We will pay for it if you want. That's
a decision
fine.
For the select board.
It's easier when you do bulk mail.
Yeah, I wouldn't have any objections. No, I think that's...
Yeah. I mean, it's a town citizen. It's about everybody involved, so...
Yeah, so the letter is a one-page document. It'll be folded in half. It just states where they can go to do it, and if they didn't have damage, if they want to still donate, where they could do that, too, as well.
I'll make a motion that we use the bulk service. Of the
Save a lot of money.
Yeah. Second.
Yeah.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
And then just to give you an update on where that's at, the auxiliary has met. We have formed the application and the cover letter that goes with that. And we have reached out to citizens in Conway to form a separate independent committee to evaluate those applications. The committee will consist of 5 people. We thought that was plenty of input. It will have 1 auxiliary member on it, and that is 1 member who has not had any damage at their house. Mm-hmm. And then the other 4 are comprised of people from the town of Conway who are not on a town committee, not a town official, did not have any damage at their home or at any of their family members' homes. So trying to keep it as...
And you can find those 4?
It dwindles the list really quickly. Makes a really small list. And we've begun reaching out to those and we're getting good response. So we're hoping to have that done within the end of this week. And then from there, they will meet once the application deadline has been met. Right now, our efforts have been focused on fundraising. I can report, as of right now, between the bank account and the GoFundMe, we're over $70,000. And we have 3 upcoming fundraising events. We have 1 on this Thursday, March 9th, from 4 to 8 p.m., Berkshire Brewing Company in South Deerfield. One of their salespeople is a resident here in town. They put together an event for us. They've got local vendors like Rafters and Holiday Pizza donating food. And anybody can come, and if you give a donation, you get to sample beer.
Great.
So that's great, and they're going to donate the proceeds back.
Is that the higher the donation, the more you get to sample?
I don't believe that's a policy, but you never know. March 19th, we'll be having an event called Conway Strong at the Conway Grammar School. This is a bunch of local ladies who got together this weekend and formulated this idea. What we're hoping to do is have you guys come as the officials, maybe give a few minute speech about things or be there to answer questions for anybody who's town citizen who's concerned or has questions.
Sure.
And the idea is that we would provide footage in the gymnasium of the aerial footage that you guys had taken, if we could get a copy of that, as well as some of the stills that have been taken, and maybe the map that you guys showed the path of, so people who are curious can see that. That'll be in the gymnasium, and then in the cafeteria, it'll be bring a finger food to share, finger food only, because we don't want to have to deal with silverware. Mm-hmm. People can sit and chat and just kind of be a community again and come together and share stories, hear things, hear the stories firsthand. So people can do, but we keep them separate. So if you don't want to see one or the other, you don't have to.
So that's Sunday the 19th.
That's Sunday the 19th from 2 to 4 p.m.
2 to 4.
And we would be doing a raffle there. So at the raffle, we have been given from Jim Murphy, a local artist in the area, the painting that he did the week before the tornado hit of the Mags Barn. So that will be auctioned off at a silent auction. It may not be finalized that night because there's actually another fundraiser the following night, and we're debating whether it's going to go 2 nights on the silent auction or not, so that's still pending. Watch for flyers. But there'll be raffle items at the Sunday one from local people who have wanted to help somehow. So there's that. And then on Monday evening, the 20th, there'll be 2 sittings of a pasta dinner, a pasta buffet, I think is how they phrase it, at Chandler's Restaurant in Deerfield.
Oh, Chandler's.
They reached out and wanted to do something.
So this is the next day?
The next day.
Yeah.
So there'll be 2 sittings. That is a Monday evening. I hope you guys will be able to make it or shift your meeting.
What time?
It's either 5 or 5:30, and then 7, I think, was the other time I saw. The flyers will be going out, so you'll be seeing those. And maybe we can get them up on the town website, I hope, just so people can find it there.
Yeah, any related information.
Great.
Perfect. You have to put up.
Super.
Maybe we can do an early select board meeting that night.
Mm-hmm.
Is that
mm-hmm.
Okay, maybe a 4:30 select board meeting?
So that'll be you pay for the dinner and the proceeds go back to the fund as well. Right. And they're doing their own raffle there that they're facilitating. So lots of good stuff happening. And the goal that the auxiliary is shooting for is everybody wants to know when will the funds be released. It's obviously the biggest priority here. So our goal is we thought a month was plenty of fundraising efforts. So we're going to close fundraising efforts as of March 31st. And we are also going to close the application process as of March 31st. So it gives them a couple weeks to get those applications in. And that way, the goal would be that by the middle to end of April, the committee will have met, reviewed, and dispensed all the funds so that by the end of April, all funds will be dispensed.
That sounds fantastic. You guys are doing a great job.
Yeah.
Great job.
I hope that covered.
Excuse me, would you like to mention the Lions Clubs?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we should talk about all the past things. So far we've had an great outpouring of support. I'm astonished at what we've had, honestly. But today in particular, the Lions Club International came to town with members from all the different surrounding towns as far as ways Southwick, Ashfield, Cumington,
Charlemont,
Deerfield. And they brought the citizens who were hardest hit in the Pumpkin Hollow area who were without power or water for an extended period of time. They brought gift cards for them. So we walked around with a few of you guys and myself and them and gave out gift cards to all the residents to go buy supplies, cleaning supplies, medical supplies, food, water, whatever it is they need. So that was really nice. And they're continuing to help with future funding. As we know what we need, they have different programs that we can reach out to, so we should touch back on that in here in the future. One of them brought up a thing about Arbor Day and trees with the school, so we might be able to have some trees donated to replant in town.
That was a nice program.
That sounds really nice. Wow. I thought it was a great idea, and the kids would do it, which would be even cooler, you know, to get the kids involved. This weekend, we had I'm going to mess up the name probably, but Springfield Rescue League? Rescue Mission. Thank you. I knew there was another word there. I'm not sure what it was. They came to town with boxes, I will say, many plural boxes, and the auxiliary on Saturday morning sorted those boxes out and made them into boxes to go to each house. Same area, the Pumpkin Hollow area that was really hardest hit, and a few outliers that were really badly hit. There's one in Poland and a couple others. And we brought boxes to the houses. They contained toiletries, food, hats, scarves, stuff like that. So we doled that out for them as well. We do have a few items that will be going to the food pantry from that. Because nobody had a baby, so.
I had planned to make this afternoon's meeting with the Lions Club, but I couldn't get off of conference calls this afternoon.
I hear you. It's been a struggle.
We were well represented.
Yes.
I'm sure.
It was well received. I think you know, the people who received it were very happy and appreciative that they got some additional support.
That's great.
And they wanted to touch base with the church.
Candy happened to show up.
Oh, that's correct.
Yeah,
so yeah. I spoke with the Reverend this morning on the issue of what's happening with the church. So
if anybody has any other stuff that they want to donate or do, obviously send them my email.
We also have donations from Lowe's Department Store.
We had
donations from LaSalle Florist.
Yep.
Yes. Right. Mm. Right.
And Baker's Country Store matched their support that LaSalle did also.
Yeah.
That's so we got two sets of donations out of that. What else was that? The Boy Scouts, Shelburne Falls Boy Scouts were in town on Sunday. They wanted to show their boys the need to help other citizens when they were in crisis areas. So they brought their boys over. They were going to clean the cemetery out in Pumpkin Hollow, but by the time they got there in the afternoon, the whole Pumpkin Hollow group had already cleaned it. So I had talked to Kenny in advance, the police chief, who's in charge of the Holland Cemetery on Shelton Falls Road, which had a lot of branches and debris down there also. And they were able to divert to there and clean that up, and the kids did a bang-up job. Mm-hmm. And looks like they're having a great time at it when they were doing it too. So they were taught that, you know, not only do you have things given to you in your life, but in parts of your life you have to give things yourself to people in need, and that's how they did it with their children. I think that's wonderful.
Yeah,
That's great.
Relevant to that, the Munson Boy Scout troop called me and wanted to come up and some Saturday and help out because they had had some experience with this.
Yeah.
And so they were more than anxious to come up. And I, at that point, when they called, I didn't have an opportunity for them. But,
We also had Hilltown Land Trust came with a group to clean up down in Pumpkin Hollow, and they cleaned up the Pumpkin Hollow Brook. And I have actually had contact, and we're hoping to have support from them for the fundraiser on the 19th at the grammar school. The Frontier Regional High School principal called and wanted to send students up to help with that, with something. So we asked them about that event, having them come up and help, you know, clean up, facilitate, stuff like that. So, so a lot of various different entities are pouring out, which is
amazing. Can I ask you a question about that? Can local landowners express an interest in having one of those groups come in and help them do cleanup? The reason I'm asking is my cousin who lives on 116, nobody's residing in the Alice house, but a lot of trees were down. Fortunately, I don't believe there was any damage to the house itself. So they're looking for, she put out a request today to have people volunteer to help them for food and beverage. So in other words, they don't want to hire somebody to help clean up. They're look. So can the townspeople request that kind of help from all these groups who are showing up that want to help, or is that kind of...
The town, as far as I understand, can't facilitate that. Is that correct?
No, we can't facilitate that, but if a private resident wants to do that, I know.
Okay. Well, that's basically what the cleanup of Pumpkin Hollow was.
It was a bunch of residents.
A whole lot of residents that cleaned up private property.
To con their own self.
I was just inquiring because of these groups who are showing up in town saying we want to help, like these Boy Scout groups and things.
Yeah.
Once the cleanup is done, if these groups are still coming out.
Sorry, and I have a question. Obviously, we've gotten a lot of requests for help and that sort of thing, and mostly we've given them your email.
Yes. It's fine. I have a list.
I'm, you know, with the Pumpkin Hollow cleanup and things, we did get the first dumpster was donated, which was great. They will need more. They'll need a chipper, that sort of thing. Is there a way to let them know, sort of more or less, you know, explicitly, that if they keep, if somebody fronts the money, or is able to, for that they can still apply for some help for that kind of work?
Well, as far as I understand it, the gentleman who fronted that dumpster doesn't live in town. So the goal of this, of the relief fund, is for any property owner in Conway. So he wouldn't have been able to apply and get the money, but if a resident does,
you
yes.
weren't meaning, I mean, that was a gift.
Yeah, that was a gift. But if a resident in town, yeah, said, fronted the money, I guess they could apply, and then it's up to the committee on... there's no guarantee on who the committee is going to give the money to or what quantity, and
right, but
I
they
don't
want
to oversee.
They could at least submit.
They can submit
that. They would be
that.
Eligible to,
yes.
to submit
yeah.
that. It might be good if you're going, if somebody's going to be involved in the next Sunday. I understand there's going to be a regular cleanup. If somebody could communicate that to those people so that they save any receipts that they get.
And they quickly need to get that dumpster emptied and perhaps that one or to rent another one.
Yeah, I had understood that was a one-time deal.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know the details of that, but I just wanted to be clear that those sorts of needs, the dumpster, if people got a chipper to get rid of some brush, that those things were eligible for.
As long as they're a resident who's gotten them, yes.
For applying for aid.
Yeah.
Also, to go along with that, I had a request from a resident this afternoon while we were walking along, that he requested to see if anybody could put up a portable toilet facility on the side of the road down here somewhere, because three or four of these homes have been disconnected from the power grid, and they have no bathroom facilities while they're doing the cleanup and working.
I'd be happy to get you the name of the cheapest people around.
This person asked me, and I told him I'll bring it up to the Board of Selectmen, but we make no guarantees. I guess that's probably some on the looks of the chipper, you know? I mean, there's not as much liability with a toilet as there is with a chipper, but, I mean, I don't know.
Well,
what's your guys' feelings on that?
My feeling has been that I understand that the town, you know, the town's responsibility and or need to distance itself from being able to provide, obviously, for every citizen in the town of Conway stuff, but it almost feels like there needs to be some kind of volunteer coordinator or something, and obviously it can't be a town person, but a town resident who might volunteer for that, because I know you're taking a list of people who would, who've offered volunteer services, but essentially you can't do anything with it, is my understanding, more or less. I mean, you can tell them, hey, go check these people out, but it almost feels like some, if we could do that, it would clean up and it would make people feel better. Obviously, I'm running the fundraising campaign and that's helping that, but I feel like if there were some way to have like a volunteer coordinator who's like, look, these events are going on in town on this day in this location, and you could call those people that have volunteered. Because I've had numerous people ask me the same question. Well, like, how can I volunteer?
This toilet facility, you know, not only that the workers that are working on the properties mm-hmm. could use, they're worried about all these
volunteers.
Mm-hmm. Like, mm-hmm. like, what do they say, 70, 80 more here this Saturday?
Yeah,
Sunday. Quite a few, yeah.
I mean,
I spoke to a selectman from another town, mm-hmm. for, I guess it was last Thursday. He suggested to me there is a very good app to organize volunteers, mm-hmm. and I will get the details on that.
Okay.
And Dave, do you have any ideas for a volunteer coordinator?
I do have a couple of names. That's something that I see us doing in the future to try to set that up. I think it needs a little bit of work to try to get the people. I'm not sure. We're kind of in the middle of this this event right now to try to backpedal quite a bit is mm-hmm. going to be hard. I mean, that's clearly one of the things that we were short on in this event and in our emergency staffing, if you will, is and talking with a lot of people, that's something we, the emergency services, needs to organize for the future. I'm not sure how much we can backpedal right now on this.
Doesn't the town have a year-round porta potty down at the park?
We have two of them. We have one down the park, and we have one down the grammar school right now. It's not being used.
Yeah, the grammar school one we've just canceled because nobody was using it.
But it's still there.
So we
could we repurpose it? Would it be possible?
I just think that the town
up to
is
the board.
Kind of protecting ourselves with a porta potty because these people have to go to the bathroom. What are they going to do? Go down and start using the brook?
Well,
they've been going to the town hall, and that's not a very good option.
And locked a lot.
It's been locked too, so. They can use that, so.
But if one of those could get, moved a quarter of a mile, I mean, how far is it up to Pumpkin Hollow?
What's that going to call the cost of town and county taxpayers if we were to put that down here for a month or something?
$130.
Less.
Or less.
Yeah.
Just going on my rate.
Are you in favor of something like that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion that we do that, Tom. Take care of that. Would you? Okay.
Thank you, Tom. Now, the other issues with the chippers and stuff like that, we can look for private funding for that, correct?
Different situation. Right.
Totally. Well, or Heidi has.
Because of liability.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay, Heidi,
that's
finished?
That's what I have on Tornado. Yes.
Okay, next item is the 250th for you?
Yeah, sure.
You got the whole show tonight.
Because I'm just not busy, apparently, in life. so, 250th. Why don't we start, because Michelle's here with me, and with the food and beverage vendor thing that you sent, Tom sent out about insurance.
What is
that? My concern about that is if we are forced to have insurance for the two-day event, we're going to lose the majority of our local vendors who do not have insurance. You can purchase a one-time insurance rider on your homeowner's insurance to cover a food truck for these people who don't do it as a regular business. It is not cheap, and I know that there are a couple of our locals who will not do that. They will not do it.
And by locals, we mean people who have come to the festival every year and done this at the festival every year and haven't had to had it so far.
And have food trucks in town.
We've had vendors at the festival that were insured.
We have not asked for an insurance policy for the festival in the 5, 6, 7 years that I have been doing it. We have not been required to provide that. We've had Board of Health standards that we need to meet, but we have never been asked to provide insurance certificates for that weekend.
And for the festival, there's no plan of starting to do that?
Well, I think that's what we're here to find out.
Well, okay, our insurance carrier has advised us that we should do that. Okay. that we should have insurance for all the vendors, those selling food and drink.
That the vendors should have?
Yes.
Insurance. The very least would be signing a hold harmless agreement, but they're strongly recommending it for any food and drink vendors. Certainly recommending it for anybody whose primary job is to sell something. They did say, you know, some not-for-profits, you know, if they're just selling something ancillary to giving out information, that wasn't a major thing. But those are the recommendations that they have.
Have they never recommended that before for the festival when we were running under the town?
I'm not sure anyone asked.
See, the problem is if somebody is uninsured and something happens with something that they serve to somebody and they're not insured, we are the next one in line to be liable. So that could be a problem. Why don't you and Tom and talk with Maya, Tom, and talk with these young ladies and see what alternatives you might have.
What was the, you said there was one assigned letter that...
A hold harmless agreement.
Yeah.
Now, what does that do?
Basically, holds us harmless.
Holds the town of Conway harmless. Yes. If these people sign this.
Yeah, it's a bit dicier legally.
A little weaker.
Yeah, it's weaker.
But you know what? Call Jack, and see what he has to say on it. Okay.
I mean, our concern about this is that I do have food vendors. That was a question that I had put out based on a recommendation of one of the food vendors that we're looking to bring in that's not a resident, but she does this as a business. She has three trucks. So she recommended asking this question. So I asked this question a couple months ago. I put out there, do you need power? Do you need water? Do you have insurance? Basically just kind of a general catch-all to see what I was up against with these food vendors. And she recommended that I ask that question, but I mean, my concern and I understand the legality, I understand that it's a concern. My concern that I just want to bring to the table is it's going to eliminate the little guys. It's going to eliminate our people, and we're going to be hiring professional food vendors to come in. And I'm pushing for the little guys, so anything we can do to help our locals.
All right, well, Tom will speak to our town council, and we'll see if we can work something out, okay?
The other question that I have come up, so that's food and beverage, was there's been people talking to me since our tornado about whether we should even be carrying on with the 250th. Not all. I've had many more who've said, no, let's continue on, but just want to bring it up so we're all on TV and all open on the board on how that goes, what your opinion of that is.
Certainly it's unfortunate that we've had the tornado at this point in time.
Yep.
The 250th is a separate event that's been in the planning stages now for
5 years.
5 years. And I think that the vast majority of people in town would want to move forward.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly I sympathize with those people who think we shouldn't move forward. But I would think that the sentiment is basically we should go forward. And I don't. What do you guys think?
Well, we talked about this last Monday,
right?
And you know, and last Monday we all asserted that we wanted. I think we actually voted. You're right.
Okay. Did you?
We voted to move forward.
To do it. I mean, you know, to go. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, obviously we recognize that Pumpkin Hollow is different, and we did have a piece gonna happen down there, and we will reach out to each of those homeowners and make sure that they're comfortable with or without that, and that may have to change if they're not. And I'm totally amenable to that. I get it. Absolutely,
we have to respect
their
feelings of those
exactly.
people.
But my feeling too was affected. To proceed ahead. But just wanted to.
We are 100% behind you.
Yeah, make sure. Okay. And then the other question was about insurance. I don't remember what it was about. I think I talked to you about insurance again. The general liability for the basically overarching thing, because we're going to have activities going on. The original plan was activities going on at the school grounds, the Pumpkin Hollow area, the property next door to OESCO, which is private property, obviously.
Right.
And then obviously the ball field area and where the fireworks are being lit off from. So just making sure that the general liability policy is going to cover all the activities kind of going on in all those areas. That's a private property that would be covered under them. We are going to also be doing a walk on Cricket Hill in the state forest. I guess it is there technically, right?
Town Farm State Forest.
Mm-hmm. So just making sure that the policy that we have in place is going to cover everything that we're talking about, I guess.
Yes, we have an excellent umbrella policy.
Okay.
For the walk, the rec department has some agreements for participating in town activities that are like a hold harmless agreement.
Mm-hmm.
You might just want to touch base with Julie Petty on that, or John Heffernan.
I'm on the committee.
Oh, well, you know.
Touch base with myself. All right,
so, yeah,
great.
You know what's involved with that.
And, they have a waiver? You know,
yeah, so some kind of a waiver.
Okay, so that you'd like to see
It puts people on notice that they should be careful.
Yeah.
For a hike, you know, through the woods.
Other question that's come up out of all of this is the funding of the additional police and EMTs, potentially staff that might need to be had for this weekend. That was not, well, it should have probably been more on my radar, but coming into this a little later, it was not quite so much on my radar in the initial budgeting process. And I knew, especially Kenny, we've spoke with him a few times about, you know, additional police staff that he's going to need and how he might fund that. Have you guys had any discussions, any thoughts on how that might be funded? Is that something that's really going to fall back on us, in which case we need to pull it out of somewhere else?
Do we know what kind of money we're talking about?
I don't know the dollar amount at this point. He's trying to work on the resources to find out exactly what he's going to need, but he felt that it might not fit in his budget that he'd already budgeted, obviously.
Sure.
And now you throw tornado on top of that, I'm going to guess that's going to blow that out of the water. Think about that.
We'll have further discussions about it.
We had the same discussion about the festival for this year, didn't
yes,
we? Because
did.
It wasn't a town event.
Yeah.
And I forget how it got resolved.
Well, yes. Well, we came up with figures for what that was going to cost, and the public safety people were good about minimizing the expense that was going to be. I had thought that it was already part of your budget. And if it
can become, and I'll pull it from somewhere, I try to pull it from somewhere else, but right now that did not have a line item for policing necessarily. We had music, you know, we had different categories like music and fireworks and stuff like that, but mm-hmm. we did not have like a policing category. And since it's a 3-day event now, there's going to mm-hmm. obviously need to be more policing events, more policing staffing. So
and
that's
I,
come
yeah.
to light as we talked with Ken and just.
I understand there might be the need for an overnight.
There is a need for an overnight. The stage that we're in the process of securing for the music comes from the town of Greenfield. Mm-hmm. I think Parks and Rec maybe or some entity there. And it requires overnight policing of that. Now that mm-hmm. we've talked about coming out of the music budget, but still there's the other nights and mm-hmm. like the fireworks and the road races and stuff like that that are going to be happening that will take police staff.
Mm-hmm. All right, we'll figure something out.
Yeah, and okay. let us know figures. As
if I can get a figure on that and see what we can do and what we can't, that's just the question is how we can.
And for the EMTs too, just
yeah.
like
yeah.
the festival.
I think we might have worked that one out, but I mentioned it because I'm not positive that we haven't worked it out. So.
Okay.
Yeah, but whatever public safety, fire, EMT,
okay.
police.
Okay.
I haven't presented to the firefighters yet because we have to have an on-duty squad then, too. We have to offer it that if they want to be paid, they will be paid. We can't suggest to them that they try to do it for free. We can't suggest to them that they'll be paid.
Mm-hmm.
But so it's going to be a per person basis
mm-hmm.
as to whether they want to be paid for what they're doing or not.
Okay. All right, so we got to figure that out a little bit more.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, I think that's kind of all I had. I will have stuff for you guys to put up on the website after my next meeting.
Okay.
So.
All right. Great.
Okay, we'll look forward to it.
You guys are doing a great job.
Thanks.
Thank you guys.
Are too.
Thank you.
So, Tom, am I contacting you or are you contacting me about the insurance?
The insurance. Yeah.
Oh, well, I'm going to check in with town council and then get
back. Okay, then you're going to get back to me?
Yeah.
Thank you, ladies.
Thank you.
Okay, next item is the draft resolution related to climate change. All right, we can...
Just a draft.
We can all review.
So it's the back page of the staple sheets.
I have not reviewed yet, no.
All right, we can take some time to review this if you want. I don't know whether we have to take action on tonight.
He's representing that?
Yes, I am.
You're...
George Butler.
Oh, George.
One of them, yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, got a couple of minutes.
Sure.
Go ahead. Yeah, so I live on, my name's George Butler. I live up on Cemetery Hill Road here. I lived here for 25 years. And I am a volunteer with the climate change lobby in Asheville. And we have about 20 offices in Massachusetts and about 380 throughout the U.S. And we're having a grassroots campaign to get things on the warrant in various towns. And we have, it will now be on the warrant in Asheville as of a week ago. It'll be on the warrant in Buckland. And we're working on Charlemont and Plainfield. And so we have a very particular policy proposal. And that policy proposal is called carbon fee and dividend. And I have gone and I gave a presentation to the Energy Committee a couple of weeks ago. I got a presentation to the Conservation Committee in a couple of weeks. And we expect to have, at some point before the town meeting, to have an educational session, a slide, PowerPoint presentation, question and answer about it. And I've been here, talked to Tom a couple of times, and Lisa, and my understanding is that if I have 15 signatures, I can get it on the warrant. Is that a correct statement?
That's a matter for any technical information like that. You need to speak with the town clerk.
Okay. All right.
If you had whatever the requisite number was,
yeah.
Then we would put it on the town warrant. And I think that I'm not sure whether it's for a special town meeting or for a regular town meeting. But there's one which requires us to do that within 60 days. And I'll just point out that in a week,
right.
60 days will include our regular annual town meeting. So if you move forward in that direction, if you could wait a week before submitting it, then we could.
Right. I looked at my calendar, the 60 days, and it looked like this was the last meeting for that, but then I talked to Lisa and she said, oh no, you've got one more for the, which would be the next.
That's a different matter.
So, okay. But I believe George is hoping that we might vote on this and say that we would put it on
either way, as a board.
Right.
Yes.
The board is slated to close the warrant next week.
Okay.
Okay, so to get this on the warrant, either this week or next week.
Yeah.
On this. Okay.
So am I right? There are two ways to do it. Either you guys say, okay, great, sure, or...
If they say no, then you have the opportunity to provide a petition. And the details for that should come from the
Jenny.
Town clerk.
Yeah.
Okay.
As she's the expert in that.
Okay.
Now, explain a little more about the carbon fee and dividend,
George. Carbon fee and dividend is it's a very simple concept. It's and it can be applied to either on the state basis or on the national basis. And what happens is that emitters of carbon dioxide, and this refers specifically to carbon dioxide only, emitters of carbon dioxide in the state or in the nation pay a fee. That fee goes into a trust fund. Mm-hmm. We have all those fees are put into that bucket. On a quarterly basis, those monies are distributed to households within the state or the U.S. on an equal basis. So you would get a check in the mail quarterly from this trust fund every year. And so what happens is, because there's an increase in the, you know, increase of the tax on fossil fuels, it expected to begin, it would be about 15 cents a gallon, say, on gasoline. But it would also be on anyone that, any product that's related to fossil fuel would have an increase. So that increase would increase throughout the year on a regular basis. We're and two-thirds of the people in state or in the U.S. would have a gain or would break even on this. The Treasury Department and REMI, which is an institute in Amherst, has their economic modeling. They have said that two-thirds would break even or would make money on this, and a third would not.
Now, which is the institute? What's the name of the institute?
REMI, R-E-M-I, Research.
Regional Economic Models.
That's it.
Oh, down in, they're down on University Avenue, right?
Just one thing I want to point out. This is seen as a, it's both people on the right and the left are excited about this. In the New York Times 3 weeks ago, February 8th, there was an article that George Shultz, Jim Baker III, who is with Ronald Reagan, I do believe, and a couple of other Republicans, grandy Republicans, say that this is the time for conservatives to get interested in climate change. There are a lot of conservatives who are not happy with the denial that we're having with the president right now. And then on the left side, you have people who, you know, you have either people who voted for Bernie Sanders or Hillary, or, you know, who voted for Hillary Clinton, and they had climate change within, you know, their program. So we really think that this is an opportunity. This is an opportunity for both people on the left and people on the right to get together on this, particularly because of what it isn't. It isn't cap and trade, which has largely been somewhat unsuccessful. It has been successful in some areas. It isn't subsidizing special interests. It's not giving money to solar or to windmills or anything like that. It's considered a free market solution. And so we think it's an opportunity, and that's why we're going for it.
Okay, so the money that's put into this trust,
yeah.
Does it encourage renewable energy at all?
Well, it encourages renewable energy because what happens is that the fossil fuels would cost more.
Right.
Renewables would not.
Mm-hmm.
But it does not subsidize them directly. But it's definitely an encouragement for everybody to be looking at renewables rather than fossil fuels.
Okay.
But doesn't this program encourage companies like gas companies that produce gasoline and propane and all the other fuels that we purchase in the United States, aren't they going to turn around and adjust their rates to their customers up higher because they've got to pay more for this carbon print? So that's going to come back into your households, the upgrade in charge.
You're absolutely right.
In anticipation that down the road in a month or two, we might get some of our money back?
Right, that's exactly. You will get two-thirds of the people in the U.S. will make either break even or make money on this.
Okay.
And a third will not. And just to mention that the lower you go on the economic scale, the better off you will be with this. This is something that does not hurt the little guy.
So how is that? How if you're... If you have low income, do you get more of the fund?
No, it's equal. It's equal. Every household gets the would get the same amount. And there's a schedule there, which is how many per household, et cetera, you know.
But you just said the lower income is going to be benefiting more from this. How do you figure that?
Because each person will pay a certain amount more. You'll pay more gasoline. If you fly to the Bahamas, you go to Europe three times a year, you're going to be paying a lot more, you know. So the little guy who doesn't take all the vacations or something, on that lower 20%, he is better off than the person who has in the top 20%. The person in the top 20% has four times the carbon footprint as that guy at the bottom. So it's seen as very progressive. You know, that was my first reaction, was like, I don't want anything to hurt the little guy. You know, this is considered to be progressive. It doesn't hurt the little guy.
So if everybody gets $100, the guy who makes $10,000 a year, $100 means more to him than the guy who makes $100,000 a year.
Right.
So in those terms, right, they're making you better
what
at the
What percentage
bottom.
Of the income that's generated off of this is being spent for administrative costs?
6% to start, and within 2 or 3, 4 years, it's expected to go down to 3 or 4%. That's with the REMI model.
That's from taking the money in, harboring it, storing it, and redistributing it.
Yes.
So, and a piece of the incentive, I'm trying to understand the incentive, why this is going to do good things or whatever. That if somebody who drives an electric car and burns no gas would still get their $100.
Yes.
Yeah. Right.
And so, as opposed to somebody who drives a Hummer, and burns a lot of gas, and their gas price would have gone up. That was what you were asking. Their gas price would have gone up. So there's an incentive for people to be frugal or to switch
to have a low carbon footprint.
To have a low carbon footprint. Great.
Right. And just as an aside, you go to Big Y, and you're looking at that apple that's flown in from New Zealand, or you're looking at that one from Clarksdale Farm. You're going to go with the local apple and not the one that was flown here from, you know, another country.
Because it has a lower carbon footprint.
Yeah.
There's two bills that are going to be in the state legislature. Do you know how they are different or which this is modeled after?
Okay, one of the bills is exactly like the program that we have here. Actually, I shouldn't say exactly. I think some of the numbers are a little bit different, but it's basically the concept is exactly the same. That is the bill that
I think one bill was by Jamie Eldridge, if I remember, and the other bill was maybe by a woman named Barrett.
The man is Barrett. He has one bill. I think that's 1021. And then there's another woman who has a bill who is exactly the same, but what she does is she takes 20% of that money and she gives it to research and design.
Uh-huh.
So it's a little bit different. Our attitude has been that the less that's given to research and design, then the more that comes back into your pocket. And basically, that is better for the guy on the lower income scale. But yeah, there are two in the 217, there are two bills now. And we talked to Senator Hines a month ago, and he backs both of them. Kulik, we haven't really talked to. I think maybe somebody has talked to him, but he hasn't had a position on it yet. But Hines was definitely behind it.
So we could be looking at realistically if this got approved. And the state bill.
This is non-binding. Excuse me, I didn't mean. But this is considered to be like a non-binding. My understanding of that is that it has no specific legal import. You know, it is urging your legislator.
So this is just to push your legislator.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
It's a resolution.
It's a resolution.
It's a statement.
To push. Yes.
And it looks pretty. I mean, the way this is phrased is extremely non-specific.
Yeah. Mm. So, it didn't mention either of the bills, which is why I was wondering.
It's the concept.
Uh-huh.
It's expressing support for the concept.
Exactly. exactly. Yeah, so I mean, I think that you could ideally not know a lot about the details, but say, look, do something, you know? Yeah. And that would be a perfectly valid position to take. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions for George?
So, you know, I'm not. We could think about it, and we could vote next week if we wanted to read this over. Mm-hmm. And it sounds like we still have a week. And would that then still give George enough time to collect signatures?
Or discussion on that would not thought on.
You don't need to worry about that time.
Check it out.
I don't.
No.
Okay.
So I was saying, don't do it before 60 days, or else we'll have to hold a town meeting a week before our town meeting.
Oh no.
So
we'll bring this back up next week.
I'd be happy to vote on it now if you want, but I'm just wondering about timeline and
John said.
Okay, what's our timeline here?
Next week is when you're scheduled to close the warrant.
Okay.
And what you can say, you could always just say, "Well, reserve a place on this." You know, right. Reserve a place for it. That's when no new things can come in.
Yeah, right.
So you can always say reserve a place for it and decide whether or not. You know, it's going to be on later as well.
And if you have a place for it, then you can be, you don't have to be before the 6th.
Then we would have time to vote whether we put it on or not.
Great.
But it would be good to get as much settled by closing.
I think we can look into this in our own. John would like time to look into it, and I would like a little more time. And we can come back next week and vote on it.
That'd be fine.
And can you leave your contact information so we can get that out to everybody as well with Lisa?
Yeah.
Just in case we don't.
So if Tom and Lisa put this back on the agenda for next week,
Yeah.
Is that okay with you, George?
Yeah. I just want to be sure the ball's in your court now, right? And it's not like I have to worry that I'm not meeting a deadline or something like that.
Right.
Beautiful.
Very good, George.
George, thank you for coming in.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Appreciate it. Appreciate it.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Very good.
On this next item, I was supposed to get Tom something this afternoon, a final copy, and I got completely tied up, so we're going to have to do this next week.
Okay.
All right. Next item is...
I can understand why.
Consider dates for meeting with the superintendent of Frontier School District.
Now,
we want to put that on the agenda for next week with the Finance Committee?
She is not available on the 13th. She's not available on any successive Monday. And I apologize. I had originally tried to set up tonight as the joint meeting with the Finance Committee and the School Committee.
Yeah.
The school. And for one reason or another, it fell through the cracks, confirming that. The dates she has suggested are the 9th, the 15th, or the 22nd.
Of April.
Of March, sorry.
Of March.
Oh, yeah. Well, we do want to get it done.
A couple days or?
As soon as possible. Now, those are a Thursday, a Wednesday,
we're talking about this
another
Thursday
Wednesday.
Is the 9th. This Thursday, isn't
and I'm not sure that she's still available for any of these particular days.
She's out.
The 9th, the 15th, and the
fundraiser. The 22nd, right?
The following Wednesday, and the 22nd is not good for me.
She can't come in during one of our second meetings.
That is what we understand at this point.
What's happening on the 15th? She's got the 15th.
I like the 15th.
How are you on the 15th?
Not great, but that's all right.
Oh, you got a virus.
I meet every.
Early is good.
Right? What time do you meet?
At 7:00.
All right. Can we do a 5:30 select board meeting on that night?
Do we want to move the whole week one up then? To then?
The what?
The whole week board meeting up to Wednesday that week?
Well, we just want to meet with her, right, to go over her budget.
Right.
So
we want to meet with the grammar school people too at the same time?
We would try to have.
Both reps here.
Yeah, and Patty Cavanaugh, who's the business manager for both Frontier and Union 38, would be present.
Yeah.
So she would be able to answer questions about either school. And, you know, we do have to coordinate this with the Finance Committee.
Should we have the principal in too, from the grammar school?
I'm sorry?
Sure.
We should have a principal in two from our grammar school here at Vincent's.
That would be ideal, yes.
If she can make it.
Now that things are not, now that things are kind of up in the air, it, we'll have to see who we can confirm and try to get as many as possible.
Okay. What time?
All right, so we're talking what? You have a 7 o'clock on that Wednesday, yep. So let's do it at 5:30. How's that?
Okay, 5:30.
Okay.
Here?
Probably at the town hall.
Across the street.
Yeah.
And we have a whole select board meeting?
That'll be 3 additional people, right?
Because we have a long select board meeting. That, I mean, that's this is the week that we are going to meet with the finance committee.
But that's not the same night.
Well, if we keep the select board meeting on Monday and have this as an additional one.
Yeah,
that's
right.
A proposal?
That's what we're talking about.
Okay.
Yeah, the Thursday, the Wednesday night would just be
for
with
school
the
boards.
Good.
School board.
Great.
All right.
That's at the town hall.
Town hall, right.
So let's make sure it's not being used somewhere else. School. Okay.
Tom, do you have something to tell us about your vacation?
Pictures or something?
Just brief stuff on some things I've been doing about the tornado. Just things you may or may not have heard. The Mass Agriculture Commissioner, a former town administrator, has asked residents who farm, including sugaring, to contact his office. The information for that is on the website. That is, if they were affected by the tornado. So that's another possible avenue. They're not saying they have anything available. They just want to know what the impact has been out here.
Okay.
I filed the insurance claim with Maya and have the claim number and contact. The apparent insurance adjuster who examined the salt shed may have been an insurance salesman independent of Maya, because we had not filed a claim at that point.
Yeah, right.
So is it still a valid
So what's
estimate?
That mean now? We gotta do it over again?
They may send out their own adjuster.
Okay, fine.
That insurance person had also suggested a particular contractor to use. So it may not, and it doesn't seem to have been related to Maya. He's also working with other residents in the area, I believe.
Maya has to do their...
They'll go through their procedure.
I've heard several stories about the agent that came and looked about, and it's only rumors that one thing was there was no damage to the side walls, and then there was a damage that the whole building had to be taken down. So have you heard anything about that?
No.
Be interested to see what they've come up with.
I have contacted Jim Bosman about using a reserve fund for pay related to the tornado. He suggested making it a town meeting warrant article. It came to mind because we have roughly $25,000 in additional pay for Conway expenses. Added to that might be reimbursement for mutual aid if we wanted to go that route. I know we've been, that Deerfield submitted some hours.
Mm-hmm. For police?
I don't know.
I think it was for the trucking of the salt, primarily.
Okay.
For the transport of the salt from our salt shed to their salt shed.
Okay.
They submitted a bill for that.
Well, that's not clear to me as to whether we owe it, because there was a statement. I'm not sure you would call it an invoice that needs to be paid.
They but could be filed to me if there was some.
But one of the select people on the board in Deerfield has indicated to me that they would be happy to help us in any way that they could for free.
Well, that's the story that I got, too.
And under mutual aid, I would suspect that that would be the case, so I don't understand our obligation under those terms.
We may not have any.
Okay.
That was a minor point related to asking, that to my belief that it may be possible to pay all of our overtime expenses, all of our additional town expenses, other than replacing the salt shed, with money that we do have available.
From the $25,000.
That's an estimate, but it's a pretty good estimate, and we have $38,000 still in the reserve fund. So we're putting all the expenses from the tornado into a particular account, a deficit account, but we haven't yet actually gone into a deficit situation. So,
are you saying consider paying all the mutual aid agreement personnel that came into our town to help?
I assume you mean the firemen overtime and all the people who worked.
Yeah, this is Conway Fire, police, yeah. Highway.
Well, I understand that. I'm talking about you talked about the mutual aid.
Yeah, I'm not talking about that anymore. Right. Because I don't know what the situation is with that.
Because that opens up a new can of worms. Not a can of worms.
Yeah.
I mean, considerably snowball on us.
So normally mutual aid is
free,
donated.
Usually, yeah.
Usually free.
And we would
be... Would it be a good gesture to pay them? Probably sure. It would be a wonderful gesture to pay them.
But right.
Under the mutual aid agreement,
we just have to be prepared to do the same.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Yeah. I haven't seen any statements beyond that. Now, you may have, but...
IMAT sent up a figure just for the use
IMAT,
filing
IMAT
with MEMA only.
Correct.
It wasn't a bill.
Correct. With the volunteer hours. Right. But we have Northampton Fire and we have Williamsburg Fire who were here.
We have Asheville Fire.
Asheville Fire.
Chelton Falls Fire. South Deerfield Fire.
I've seen none of those.
Whately Fire.
And so they're all mutual aid. Might they not send a bill? I mean, what happens normally when we cover another town?
We don't bill them.
Well, you don't bill them.
It wouldn't be a bill. It would be a statement of hours. Right. And the thing is, if this were a FEMA-related, if this came under FEMA, we would be tracking hours, personnel, and equipment that were used, and it would be up to this town to organize all of that information and submit for reimbursement, mm-hmm. which we would then make sure mm-hmm. got to the individual towns. Yeah. This is not something that has reached that level. Thankfully.
Yep.
I don't know what do we have in existence a highway mutual aid agreement?
I believe we do. I think it's new. I think it's relatively new.
It's got to be fairly really new because I don't think we had it when I was in there mm-hmm. 3 years ago.
Yeah, I think we do. The point being that I believe we will be able to pay all of our expenses related to the tornado without going into a deficit.
Okay.
So it will not impact next year's taxes.
Mm-hmm.
We should be able to get out of it. The way that I see that happening is through the reserve fund.
Mm-hmm.
There could be transfers between accounts at the end of the year as well. There are different ways that can be done.
Yeah.
But so far, it looks as though the costs can be contained within the reserve fund. What Jim has suggested is rather than having that be a finance committee decision, have it be a decision of the town at town meeting. So...
Well, the town meeting doesn't need to vote to spend reserve funds. They do it every annually, anyway.
It does not need to.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is that when I spoke with Jim Bosman, he suggested that that might be a more appropriate way to proceed because it was a town-wide event. And it would be better if the whole town voted on it happening.
Does that mean we wouldn't pay anybody until then, until town meeting?
No, we are allowed to go into... I mean, no.
Okay.
It doesn't mean that.
Okay, great.
No.
But what would happen in a catch-22 situation where we paid our people this week, like we are, for all the overtime expenses, Mm-hmm. We went to town meeting, voted, and the townspeople said, no, we don't want to pay it.
You know, our normal procedure our normal procedure is that the finance committee votes on that.
Right. Yes, which is why I asked them that.
Yeah, I don't think we need to go to town meeting on it.
I think it's just yeah, that's what that reserve fund is set up for.
Yeah, things like that's exactly why we set it up. All we need is their vote to move ahead with it. I don't know why he's trying to push it all to town.
I will let him know.
Yeah.
I certainly hope and would expect the town would vote for it, but it doesn't feel right.
The highway superintendent is preparing to open Whately Road. He would have done it today, but some additional material had been piled so that it went into the street a bit, which he's going to push back so that he can
open. He did open it.
The road's open now.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. He worked there late today and he got it open.
There is some tornado-related damage to the fence at Pumpkin Hollow Cemetery, but there is even more need of repair that's not tornado-related.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So there is wood that is there in on-town property that we will have to get rid of and clean up ourselves as the town. I'm not sure it's even worth filing a claim on one section of split rail fence when there are half a dozen of sections that actually need to be replaced.
To go along with this, Tom, we all saw it, we probably just weren't thinking about it, just pumping all the fence just came up. We need to have the fence repaired along the walkway by the ball field. ASAP before somebody steps off that edge and tumbles down into the ball field. There's three or four of those rails missing.
Mm. Oh, right.
I don't know if they came down during the tornado or not, but that needs to be done ASAP. Remember, we had an incident past fall. Yeah.
Okay, if you can send me details of that and let me know exactly where it is, I'd appreciate it. Patricia Vincasey's work was written up in the Globe. As some disaffected Scituate residents thought she might be acting illegally. And the town office also got a phone call from a Boston area cell phone suggesting she was improperly appointed. So that's just a little note, a little follow-up on things. The MMA has a good article about her work and what happened, and I believe you've seen the Boston Globe article that it was an opinion piece that came out. She had wanted to keep it very low-key, but
somebody was trying to blow it up. Man.
Someone blew it up, yes. So those are just some notes on tornado follow-up that I've that I have.
Okay.
May I add one or two?
Feel free, David.
Thank you.
Okay.
I'm
first of all very pleased. I'm just very pleased with the way in which the community has responded and come forward. Today I tried to canvass all of the people on Pumpkin Hollow just to assess the needs, because I know as of the last couple of days there was a couple of power outages still, but all of that has been taken care of. So I think I missed two people, but I talked with everyone else because I really wanted to know, what do you need? I was pleased to find that people are dealing with it without having to rely on outside sources. So most everyone has stepped up to the need and is taking care of it. There's one issue that remains is probably going to remain for some time, and that's and by the way, this is common with all of these kinds of situations, and that is the one of debris. It's not clear to me or anyone right now how we're going to manage all of this debris.
And you mean construction debris or?
Pretty much the storm debris.
Wood debris.
It's the trees, there's a pile of metal up there. There are probably, I'm going to guess, 20 garbage bags sitting on the common down there, and certainly a lot of debris. And from the efforts yesterday, by the volunteers, apparently they've moved a lot of that stuff down to the road in anticipation that I guess somebody is going to take care of it. So that's a little bit uncertain. I don't know how we can resolve that tonight. It probably needs to work itself through. But there is that by the road in the front and around the houses. I've told everybody that that's their problem, that there's something that they're going to have to arrange to do. The town is not going to be able to step up to that. Nevertheless, there is a lot of debris down by the road. I'm not sure how that's going to be dealt with right now.
So Bob and I, when we were riding back from meeting with the Lions Club, we were looking at this pile of aluminum metal pieces and stuff like
from
that.
From the roofs.
That has been all located into one pile.
Right.
Unfortunately, where they set it is on the, right on the sidewalk.
Right.
So people walking down there could get hurt on the night. So I would like to suggest that we have our highway superintendent send his crews up there and pick up this small pile of metal debris and take it up to the transfer station and put it in a metal bin so that we, town, can get reimbursed some money for it.
It has value. Mm-hmm.
It has a little bit of value.
Sure.
Yeah. That would be my suggestion on that part.
What about the other stuff?
Could we get a vote on that? Because that's, again, the town taking on private, you know. As I understood it, the people there have a plan to keep working weekly on...
Right, but that didn't include the metal. Bob was talking specifically about the metal, which
biggest concern is the metal, because somebody can get hurt walking down the sidewalk.
So I agree with you. I mean, do we need to vote on this so that we can, right, Ron officially
we'll make
permission?
A motion that we ask the highway department to pick up that particular pile of
as soon as
debris.
They get to it.
Yeah. All right, do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you, David.
But what Tom was saying was, yes, on Sunday there was talk about a plan, but it was going to be handled by them. They were looking to say, you know, if the residents there could rent a wood chipper and with a truck that the wood chipper blows the wood chips into.
Right.
And drive along the road. And so many people during the cleanup were moving a lot of the debris down to piles along the road so it could be easily chipped.
Okay. So you think that there is a plan, or that's going to happen perhaps next Sunday, because that's when they're planning to begin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If you meet with that group, and I was not down there, or she is someone from that group, if they have no means of disposal of the wood chips, Quentin Auntie's farm on Ron Brucker would love to have the wood chips.
It feels to me that there ought to be a farmer that would want them. He probably beds his cows on them just like I used to. Bed my sheep on them.
Keep that in mind, okay?
Yeah.
That'll be good.
Okay. Thank you, David.
Welcome.
Concerns of the selectmen. Do we have any concerns tonight, gentlemen?
No. Let's not do this again right away.
Okay.
My concerns were, we discussed them all tonight already.
Okay, mail. Let's see what we got in the mail. We got a notice of filing and procedural conference and public hearings from DPU, which, if you're interested, you could read this, but it's not really interesting stuff. We're starting to get applications in for the Germain Scholarship.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
So that's in the mail. We got a letter from Massachusetts Fiscal Alliance asking for support of a couple of bills to come through the House that would require that both the Senate and the House provide a preliminary estimate of local aid for the next year to cities and towns by the end of March. Okay. That's what they're asking for, and that's probably not really going to happen, but anyway, that's what they're asking for. Okay. Any other announcements? No. Okay, our next scheduled meeting is for March 13th here in the town office. If there's no further business to come before the board, I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.